do, and I want to, it's not just me talking, you've listened to a lot of me talking, and the fact you've come to this is very kind of you. We've got an hour, is that right?
Yeah.
Great, basically. Yeah. I've got three areas that I want us to talk about in terms of what does it mean to be young men who believe in the resurrection enough to be different in these three areas. And the three areas we're going to talk about are not related to each other, they're going to be quite random. I want us to talk about ambition, what we want to do with our lives. I want us to talk about how we treat women. And then I want us to talk about how we use our money. All right? That's what we're going to talk about. Exciting. thanks for being here. Let's start, though, with ambition. I want you to turn to the person next to you and tell them, what's the first thing you remember wanting to be when you grow up? So not what you want to be, not now, but when. Did you ever have a kiddie ambition about what you want to be? Does anyone reckon that the person they were speaking to had the best ambition? Any good ambitions? Yeah. Wanted to be a
pastor.
Wanted to be what?
A pastor.
Oh, terrific! Do you know, one of my sons said to me, I've got three sons, and one of them said to me, I want to be a lawyer, but if it doesn't work out, I can always be a pastor. So thank you for wanting before being a lawyer. It's great. Any other ambitions? Yeah.
He wants to be a bin man.
Great. I think the light is quite appealing, isn't it? The kind of all that stuff. I wanted to be a Blue Peter presenter. Is Blue Peter even on? Do you know what Blue Peter is?
Yes.
Yeah. That kid's TV program. Here's my question. Do you think it is right to be ambitious? Good. Well, that was fairly universal. Do you think there's a danger with ambition?
Yes.
So what we've got to try and work out is, how do you be ambitious without getting it wrong? Let me tell you a story. When I was, when my kids were very little, I went into school. And they were doing an assembly, and the kids were all singing this song. And you'll remember this sort of thing, right? We've all done this, you know, you have a little part, a choir, and everyone stands there, and no one really wants to be there. And the parents were all watching. And the song that the kids sang said, I still remember now, it was like a Disney theme, that sort of feel to it. And the words of the chorus, and you may even have sung this song when you were at school. It went, I can be anything at all. I can climb the highest mountain. I can hear the ocean calling, vast and free. I can be anything I want with the dream inside to guide me, just as long as I believe in me. And so you've got this, all the kids are singing it, and singing really beautiful, it's really beautiful, they all sing with big smiley faces. I can be anything at all. And now, at the end of the song, what do you think all the parents were doing at the end of the song? What do you think all the parents were doing? Crying. All of them were crying. Exactly. The teachers were crying. The head teacher was crying. The kids looked confused. And so everyone was very moved by this song. Let me tell you how I felt. I was angry. I was really angry. And the reason I was angry was because it's not true. That song isn't true. It's not true that you can be anything you want, that you can climb the highest mountain. It's not true. Because I looked at these kids, and I could see that, you know, here's one who wants to be a Premier League football player. I don't want to be rude, but I could tell just by looking at him, that wasn't going to happen. Here's the kid who wants to be something else. Here's the kid who wants to... And what we're doing is we're telling people you can achieve anything. Or think about the Olympics, right? We just had the Olympics. And someone wins a gold medal, and it drives me mad. Because after they win a gold medal, they get interviewed. And they say, how do you feel? How do you feel? They go, oh, it's amazing. This just goes to show that anyone can achieve anything. No, it doesn't show that. There are seven people behind you in a heap, in tears, because they didn't get the gold that they've been working for. Only one of you achieved it. Actually, what it shows is you're a phenomenally talented athlete. And here's the thing, right? We are in a culture where you are being told you can do anything and you can achieve anything. And the trouble is that we are not preparing people for failure. Because on the day when you fail, whose fault is that? It was your fault, because if you just believed enough, if you just worked a bit harder, you could have achieved anything, but you didn't, you failed. And we're not preparing people to be ordinary, to be average. Look, I don't want to upset you or anything, but statistically speaking, most of you are going to be average. It's just what it means. That's sort of how it works. And yet, all of us aspire to be special. This is dangerous. So if one of my kids had gone up to their primary school teacher, and they said, what do you want to be? Josiah, what do you want to be when you grow up? And he'd said, Miss, I want to be average. I'd like to live a mediocre life and do ordinary things. What would she have said to him? Oh, come on.
Dream big.
You can do more than that. That's too small. Your ambition is too small. But you're not seeing that if you keep telling kids that, you're not preparing them for the day when they fail. You see, what you discover when you read the Bible, and what you discover when you know who you are because of Jesus, it sets you free from the need to define your identity by what you do and what you achieve. So why does, let's look at part of our text. Get to Mark chapter 10. If you've got a Bible, get to Mark chapter 10. I'll go to this. If you haven't got that, don't worry, just listen. It's fine. I'll talk through it again. We're going to meet some lads who were very ambitious. They had big dreams. They're called James and John. And this is in Mark chapter 10 and verse 35. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, I mean, their dad was called Zebedee, right? That's cool. I mean, that's a good start in life, right? Your dad's called Zebedee. Anyway. And they came to Jesus and they said, Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask. Right? Come on. Imagine this, right? You go to Jesus and go, Jesus, we want you to do whatever we ask. I think Jesus would be quite in his rights to go, shut up and sit down. But he doesn't, because he's kind and he's patient. So he says to them, what do you want me to do for you? Right, here's their ambition. What do you want to be when you grow up, James and John? What do you want to be? Let one of us sit at your right and the other at your left in your glory. We'd like you to be on the throne, and we'll just sit either side of you. We'd like the most important places in your kingdom. Now look, are they dreaming big? Yeah, I mean, that's pretty spectacular. That's big, right? But what Jesus says to them is he says, you don't know what you're asking. You don't know what you're asking. Can you drink the cup I drink or be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with? What a question, right? And they look at each other and they go, we can. I don't think they've got the fullest idea what Jesus is talking about. Jesus goes, can you drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with? And they go, yeah, I think we can do that. They don't know what he's talking about. Actually, what Jesus is talking about is the fact he's going to die. He's going to die on the cross. He's going to drink the cup of God's wrath. He's going to go under the punishment of death in baptism. His cross is his baptism. And then he's going to rise again. Jesus, can you walk that way? And they think, yeah, we can. They don't understand what they're asking. You see, Jesus is going to walk this resurrection shape we've been talking about. And they just want to go straight to life. They want the glory, but they don't want the suffering. And then all their mates come around, and this is verse 41. They really get really cross with James and John, because James and John asked this stuff. And Jesus teaches them, and he says, you know that those who regard them as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them. Their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Stop being people who grasp for power. Stop being people who want to be the best, who want to be the highest, who want to be the greatest. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. This is radical. And whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for men. The world says you've got to grasp, dream big, aim high, go big, right? You've got to climb the ladder. Jesus says, go down. Choose to serve. This is very radical. Have you ever felt jealous of anyone? Any of your friends? There was a girl, who I was so jealous of. She was called Caroline. And I was in a band. Not like a cool band, a sad, kind of like a wind band. Not like a cool, rocking out band, not like Amy, but like in a, like, more an orchestra. Anyway, I was first clarinet, right? I played first clarinet in the orchestra. I know. I was pretty proud of myself. Until this monk girl walked into the room with what looked suspiciously like a clarinet. I said, it's okay, it's another clarinet, but it's alright, because she could be third clarinet. But when she started to play, it was very clear she was better than me. And so a couple of weeks went by, and then the awkward conversation from the leader of the orchestra who came and said, Jonty, would you be second clarinet? Because we'd like Carol to be first. How'd you come back from that? Hated her. Wanted her fingers to fall off. Yeah, anything, right? Anything to stop her from playing. You see, if you've got to climb higher and higher and higher, you will be so, so stressed about everyone around you. You'll be stressed because they're a better footballer than you. You'll be stressed because they're faster than you. You'll be stressed because they're better looking than you. You'll be stressed because they're getting better grades than you. And even if you're top, you can't relax, right? Because there might be Caroline coming around the corner who's going to knock you off your perch. And so this obsession with being the best and being the fastest and being the cleverest and being the funniest and being the handsomest, this obsession with having the biggest muscles, whatever it is, this obsession, it leads to a life of stress and insecurity. And some of you are experiencing that right now, okay? Because we believed that the goal of our lives is to get as high as we can. Jesus comes and says, hey, why don't you flip it the other way around? You see, Jesus is the greatest of greatest, the highest of highest. He has nothing to prove. But he came down. He came down to serve, and to serve us, and to love us. He says, that's greatness. And that is where true freedom is found. So think about I'm going to give you one more idea, and then I'm going to get to talk about this in your groups. Your sort of lines. Have a think about this. If you are, and I know you probably don't go shopping that often, but we'll try it, okay? If you go to a supermarket, imagine going to a supermarket, and it's busy, and there's big queues waiting for to check out. Or any time when you're queuing, and there's several queues, and you've got to pick the right queue, you know the kind of game. And you stand in the queue, yeah, like on the motorway, like lanes of traffic, all this sort of stuff, anything like that, where you're basically queuing, and you're watching the other queues, and they're going faster than you. It's a very stressful experience. I had that, like, it's kind of instinctive. It's sort of being a man, I think. This kind of obsession with not letting anyone get ahead of you. It's like that old lady in the red car, she's got in front of me. Anyway, and so the queue is moving forward and you're trying to judge it and you think, oh yes, I'm moving quicker than them. And then there's some old lady who's got little coins and she loses them all and she's so slow and come on. And then this queue and there's suddenly opening a new queue and you're like, I don't know where to go here. It's very stressful. There's a way that you can stop all of that stress. I promise you there's a way. It's really simple. And I want to encourage you to try, next time you find yourself, if you ever find yourself in that situation, and if you can drive, try it. It will change your life. You can actually try this. Here's how you take all the stress away. You turn to the person behind you in the supermarket queue and you say to them, would you like to go in front of me? And suddenly you don't care anymore. You don't care. It makes no, you just don't care at all about the lane over there, how fast it's going. Why? Because you've chosen to serve someone else. It takes, similarly in a traffic queue, if you let people pull in, it takes all of the stress away because you choose to serve. And actually what Jesus is teaching is be men who choose to serve. Be men who are ambitious to serve others. Who make it your ambition to do everything you can and to use all that you have to serve other people rather than push yourself to the front. So on the day someone faster than you comes in, on the day someone better at clarinet comes in, you go, wow, this is great, you're better than me, this is terrific. Because I don't care. Because my identity is not tied up in how good I am at clarinet. My identity is tied up in the fact that Jesus came and served me, loves me. The heart of sin pushes you higher. The heart of love pushes you down. Love to serve. So I want to encourage you, be men who choose to serve. Choose to serve like Jesus. Why don't you, I want you to tell your groups, and I want you to talk about someone, probably not by name, but someone that you find it easy to be jealous of. Okay? Someone that you find it easy to envy. And think about, what would it look like to serve? Or, so you could do that, or talk about, how do you see this in your school? How do you see this in, you know, this competition, this desire to be the best and to be the highest? Now look, I'm not saying that you shouldn't be athletes. I'm not saying you shouldn't train hard. But if that's your identity, it will cripple you. And if you've never watched the film, if you're into sport, particularly into athletics, if you've never watched the film Chariots of Fire, you need to go and watch the film Chariots of Fire and see what this looks like. To be someone who, Eric Little, was someone, an amazing athlete, but he was not at all defined by how fast he ran. Anyway, that's for you. Turn to your groups, just talk about that for a few minutes. How do you deal with this thing of ambition? How do you deal with this thing of actually being willing to serve? Being willing to be ordinary in order to serve others. It'd be really good if there are any... we're going to hear some ideas from you guys. We're going to hear some of the things you were talking about, if you want to. Or if there's any questions you've got or anything you disagree with, it'd be great to hear anything anyone was saying. Do you want to give us a couple of thoughts on ambition? Yeah.
I've got a question.
Yeah.
How do you guard against that in a Christian context?
Yeah, great.
Being jealous of a pastor.
Yeah.
Wanting to outdo others in serving.
Yeah.
Surely the same one is it present?
Absolutely, it's present. And I was just sitting here thinking, I want to say this has been one of the biggest fights of my life, the fight against pride and the fight against ambition, kind of selfish ambition. So here's an honest, right, here's an honest thing from my heart. I turned 48 on Thursday, so I'm old, and I've been a pastor for over 20 years. I still find that when I hear another church in London has had loads of people become Christians and is growing, my first instinct is still, they're probably doing something wrong. And how come they can't? You know, why should it be them and not me? And you're like, how can my heart be so selfish that I'm like, people heard about Jesus and coming to know Jesus, what is wrong with me? And I want to say to you, actually, pride is such a powerful force in particularly in young men's hearts. And the answer to your question is you just have to fight it. You just have to keep fighting. And you have to fight it in such a way that says it's not about me. So your question about how you don't be jealous. I found I need to pray most for the people that I'm jealous of. So if I'm praying for someone that they would flourish, so there's a church that I particularly feel this with. Every time I pass their building, which is near me, I pray for them. And I pray that God would bless them, and I pray that God would grow the church. It's sort of like, you don't just fight pride by going, oh, I'm trying to be proud. You fight pride by
praying that other people would be blessed, and then seeking that they would be built up. And you know, if someone's like, someone asks you to come and speak to me, you go, "Oh, you can ask this guy down the road. He's great. You should ask him." You know, you're pushing others forward, and then you sort of take a joy in that. It's like asking the person behind you to just come forward. You're like, "Oh, I don't feel guilty. I don't feel proud anymore. This is great." But pride is powerful, and you'll all experience it, right? You'll all experience it. And my hope and prayer is that there'll be some in this room, well, all of you would use your lives in all sorts of ways for God, and some of you would be going full-time into working for a church or going overseas or doing amazing things, the potential in this room, but pride is the thing that could hold you back. Because pride is a heart that says it's about me. So I think you're a fighter, and God has ways of honouring you along the way. But it's just a battle that goes on and on. But I think the best piece of advice someone gave to me was, don't let pride stop you doing good things. Right? Don't think, oh, they'd be proud to do that. No, do good things. You know, try stuff. Have a go. Be ambitious. Do stuff for Jesus. And then as you feel proud, get on your knees and confess it and say, "I'm sorry." But let's go again. Cool. Any other thoughts? Or, yes? Yeah, and it's so powerful, isn't it? And actually that becomes part of our identity, that I feel like I'm not as good as that person, I feel rubbish. But this is why, actually, if you could really experience being a Christian, knowing what it is to be loved by Jesus, it's so powerful to set you free, to really love people. Okay, I'm gonna move us on, because I want us to see how we're going. I think pride, I think one of the second areas that is a real battle for us as young men, is how we treat women. I'm not just talking about sexuals, I'm not just talking about pornography, I'm talking about the way we treat women. And I don't often get a chance to talk to a group of young guys, and I'm like, look, I just want to share with you what I think the Bible teaches and my heart to say to you guys, be men in respect and love and honour women around you. You don't need me to tell you that men have done a really bad job of that. As men, we have a tendency to turn women into objects for our satisfaction rather than image bearers of God for us to serve and to love. And I want to challenge you to be men who, even now at your young age, start, you make it your ambition to treat women with purity and godliness. There's loads of places we could look for this. Maybe let's just go to Colossians. If you've got a Bible. Again, don't worry, I'm only going to read one verse, so don't worry too much. Says in Colossians chapter 3 and verse 5, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. So all of us have within us sexual desire. All of us. And that sexual desire is part of how we are created. Sexual desire is a good gift that God gave us. Sex is God's good gift, and a desire for sexual intimacy is a godly good desire. But the trouble is that our good desires can become controlling desires. So actually, the desire for food is a good desire, but it can become a controlling desire. The desire for all sorts of things, if it begins to control us, becomes turned in on ourselves, and it becomes about lust rather than about serving. And so sexual desire, which is a good desire, can and often does become a controlling desire. And the good design that God has for marriage, sex between one man and one woman in marriage for life becomes distorted, and we begin to take that good desire and begin to direct it towards things that God says are not good and are not the right place for those desires to be fulfilled. And that means we can begin to see and to treat women as objects to satisfy us, rather than as partners God has created for us to walk alongside and to love. But I think the problem is, what happens is, we sort of know that there's some stuff we're not supposed to do, and we're not supposed to have sex. You probably have been taught, right, if you've been around church, if you're a thing like this, you've probably been taught you're not to have sex before marriage, you probably know that, and you shouldn't look at pornography, you probably know that. You sort of know these things, but the trouble is they're still very powerful. Even if we know that we're not supposed to do it. And the danger can be that we think, I've just got to say no to it. Say no, no, no. But that's hard. And for many of us, we find that battle to say no too hard. Okay, let me give you a picture, Tabby. I wasn't going to use this today, but you guys haven't heard me talk before, so you've heard this before. But anyway, let me give you a picture. I hope this will really help you. Imagine I put one of my sons on a chair in the middle of a room, and I do an experiment with him, because that's what all good parents should do, right? They should experiment with their kids. And so I put him in the room, and then over here on a table, I put a big pile of sweets. And I say to Josiah, you must not eat the sweets. And then I leave the room. Okay, let's do when he's sort of about 5 years old. Okay, look at him, right? Watch him. Where's he looking? At the sweet. There's nowhere, and it's so obvious he's looking at the sweets, right? And in fact, as he sits on his chair, he'll sort of even lean. It's like they're actually physically pulling him towards them. You can picture that, right? And he sort of move his chair, he dropped a pen, oh, I dropped something, and he'll move along towards. And bit by bit, these sweets that he knows he's not supposed to eat, he gets closer and closer until he finds himself at the table, and then he goes, well, Dad didn't say I couldn't touch them, he just said I couldn't eat them. So he begins to sort of like, these feel nice. And then he goes, Dad didn't say I can smell them, he said I couldn't eat them. So he goes, sort of unwraps them, and then of course it's inevitable he's going to start eating, right? Inevitable. Now, that is how most of us kind of feel about fighting sin, fighting desires that are wrong. Now, of course, he could tie himself to a chair, right? He could get some ropes and tie himself to the chair. But where are his eyes going to be? Still on the streets. And what's his experience going to be of life? Is that joy? Is that joyful? No, it's miserable, right? There is a way, and okay, this is the key, there is a way that I can make it easy for him to not eat the sweets. I can make it so easy. I can make it a joy for him to not eat the sweets. All I have to do is put something this side of the room that is more attractive to him. So, if I put Granny on this side of the room, suddenly, he's not interested in the sweets anymore, because he so loves Granny. This is going to sound wrong, but forgive me. Granny has greater pulling power. The sweets are pulling in this way. Granny outpulls the sweets. Right, here's the thing, right? What if the way that God has set us up in order to fight sin is not that we sit on a chair going, I can't do it, I can't have it, I mustn't do this. Actually, what God has given us is, he says, you need something greater. You need something that you love more, something that's more attractive to you. That's Jesus. And when you see Jesus as the one who's risen from the dead, his resurrection power, here's Jesus risen from the dead, if we could see him as he truly was, we would not care about sexual sin ever again. We wouldn't care. Why would I want that? Why would I want it? I watch pornography, which just leaves me feeling rubbish and useless anyway. It's a lie. It's all a lie. Everything here is a lie. And here is Jesus who offers me life and beautiful life and resurrection life forever. You see, the battle with sin is not about saying no and coming up with rules that keep you safe. The battle with sin is about loving Jesus so much that sin doesn't have a hold on you anymore. Now, let's not be naive. That sounds all very simple. That's incredibly hard. But what I want to show you is that joyful obedience to what God says about sexual relationships, joyful obedience to what God says about how we should use this precious gift, is found in knowing Jesus. Because as you know him, you find joy in him. And those things become less attractive. So look, if you're someone who is struggling with that, you want to live God's way, you know that what is over there is wrong, you know you don't want to live that way. Perhaps you are tempted to be sleeping with your girlfriend, or you're tempted to be looking at stuff you shouldn't let go. Perhaps that's very appealing to you. I want to encourage you, there is hope. Please don't despair. It's a real battle. It's hard. It's really hard. But there is hope. And the hope is not found in you being strong enough. The hope is found in Jesus being powerful enough. So the challenge for you is to get to know him better. Be men who get to know Jesus. Be men who love Jesus. Be men who see that Jesus is so worth it. On the day when, if you get married, it's not guaranteed, but some of you in this room will get married. On the day you get married, you will not think, "Oh, I wish I'd slept with more people." You will not think. I promise you won't think that. On the day that you get married, you will not think, "I wish I'd looked at more pornography." You won't think that. On the day when you get married, you won't think, "I wish we'd done a bit more as boyfriend and girlfriend." On the day when you get married, there will be a joy in being able to receive this gift of sex that God has given you. Not about lust and about my desires, but about honouring God and honouring the person who gives you to marry. So, I would encourage you to fight sin now for the sake of the woman that you one day might marry. What an amazing thing it would be if you took it seriously now, so that when God calls you to be a husband, you're ready to be a husband. It's because you've been fighting sin and not giving in to it. And even if you never get married, I'll tell you this much, on the day when you meet Jesus, you will not think, "I wish I'd slept with more women. Oh, it's a shame I sort of missed out on all of that stuff. I wish I had a bit more of that." Now, when you meet Jesus, you'll see everything you sacrificed to him and everything you fought was worth it, because he's worth it. So look, there it is. That's the fight. I know you've heard it before. I just want to say to you, don't stop fighting. Don't give in to it. Jesus is so much better. And he's worth it. Right, do you want to let's take another little 2 minute break. If you've got any questions, then come up with it in your groups, or any thoughts you want to say. Nice thing about asking a question in the group is you can say something in my group, ask this, rather than being me, blow someone else. So just any questions or thoughts around what I've just said about kind of how we treat women and kind of sexual sin, there's so much more about how you love and honor women. But talk quiet now, and if you've got any questions, you can come back. And then I've one more fun thing. Any thoughts? We're just skating over. I'm just trying to chuck out ideas for you guys. Yes?
I read your book called Hero, I think.
Oh, yeah.
And one of the analogies in that was like you were trying to wrap up a concrete thing with a hammer.
Yes.
And your son came out.
Yes.
With a little plastic one.
Yes.
And tried to do it with you.
Yes.
But you didn't do it. But then you hired a massive
digger.
Digger.
Yes.
To do it for you. Is that
brackets, this is a reference to a book I might read. Thank you, that's very good. I forgot that. So the idea that my little sanctuary plastic hammer is tries to help me smash up the concrete in my garden is like laughable, isn't it? It's kind of like it's going to have its powers and no effect. And I think you're right. Often the way we try and fight sin is like, and then we go, oh look, it's defeated me again. Because our hammers, it's just like, oh look, plastic hammer's not strong enough. We do. We need a massive, great power that is stronger than us. You can help us to smash it. And I think this whole area of sexual sin, it enslaves so many men. And I guess I just want to appeal to you. If you're down that road, ask for help. Get some help. Right? Don't just settle. I know it's hard, but ask for help. And if you're just thinking of starting down that road, I'm like, it leads you to misery and frustration and emptiness. It will not. I promise, it will not satisfy you. The only place that sex will satisfy you is within marriage. And you can try all you like, and you will damage and hurt yourselves and others. And I guess I just want to say to you guys, treat this thing with such respect, and treat the women in your life with such respect that you are ready for the day when God might call you to be a husband. Okay, yeah, go.
We're talking about group, about your illustration, appreciated the advice to find something that finds Jesus more attractive, and that's part of our approach.
Yeah.
So, if there are ways, practical things you can do to take the sweets off the table, then that makes sense.
Yes.
What advice would you give to a young person around smartphone?
Yeah.
Because that's the sweet side on your left, right?
Yeah.
Thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think you need to understand, and I guess you do know, but you need to understand how powerful that thing is. But I did not grow up with a smartphone. But I was not a teenager with a smartphone. If I wanted to look at pornography, I had to go to a newsagent, reach up to the top shelf, and buy a magazine. There was no way I was going to do that. Like, no way. So the only access I had was if my mates had got a magazine from their dad or whatever. That was the only access I had. You know, that, and that was powerful enough. You've got it, like, all the time in your pocket, and no one sees what you do. Like, it is so, so powerful. And I actually, I want to encourage you to be more radical. You know, sometimes we go, oh, I really, really want to stop doing this thing. And then you go, but I don't want to give up this. And so of course it will keep happening. And Jesus said, if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off, right? Do something dramatic. So it might be that you decide to get rid of your smartphone. I don't know how I could live without it. Well, perhaps you can. In fact, you might even find life is more satisfying. And even as a kind of, like Abraham and Alter, you know, with Isaac on the altar, you say, I'm willing to give this up for you because I'm so serious about being a man of God. Now, don't hear me say that everybody, that no Christian should have a smartphone. I don't think that's true. But I think it's too hard for a lot of people. And you just got to be honest about that. Your life will be okay without a smartphone. Like, honestly, you will be alright. Other than that, then, finding ways to put safeguards around it, finding ways to get softer on it that holds you accountable. Although I'm pretty skeptical, I think most of you are smart enough to be able to get around it, so I don't think that doesn't, you know, let's be honest, right? I think getting rid of stuff that is causing you to sin. And you might even just find the joy of being sacrificial and saying, Jesus, I love you more than this, and I'm going to give you this up for you.
Just wisdom on being good friends, good girls.
Yeah, great. Again, I think it's really difficult for you guys, because I think as soon as you hang out with a girl, you know, you go out for a coffee with a girl or anything, everything's like, oh, they're going to get mad at me, doing like all this dumb stuff that happens. And it's very difficult to build friendships that aren't romantic, but just friendships, right? Because friendship is good, friendship is beautiful. But you need friends who aren't just men, you need friends who are girls as well. You need both men and women who are your friends. But you also have to recognise that you will love women best when you are clear about your intentions. So can I say to you, flirting is one of the most unkind things you can do. Because when you flirt with a girl, when you're something like, give the impression you're interested, or have, it's so confusing for them. And they don't know where to stand, they don't know what they think, they don't know what to think. So I think, as far as you can, be men who are clear in your intentions. If you're romantically interested in a girl, you tell them, you say it straight up, and you say, let's talk about this. To be careful in communicating. Now, let me just say, it will always get messy, because it's nearly impossible to navigate this without a bit of mess. And part of it is dealing with that when that happens, when you've hurt someone, when you've got it wrong. Actually being the man who says, I'm sorry, I'm really sorry, I got that wrong. And being quick to say sorry. But I'd be really careful of exclusive friendships, I'd be really careful of friendships that become too intense, that, you know, I'd have lots of friends, hang out with groups, enjoy men and women in groups, and you know, have loads of friends. I think when a friendship becomes too exclusive too quickly, it can end up becoming quite painful. We just had, just last Sunday, I sat down with two of our students at the Church Ryan, because their friendship had become very close, and she thought he was interested in being in more. He didn't, and he told her he didn't, and it was all a big mess. And they said, now what do we do? And I had to talk them through. He was like, let's just never see each other again. I was like, no, let's not do that. You know, it's like, you know, it's a mindful, but the more you can just be careful in treating them as a sister and love. So it's obvious stuff. Any other questions? Great. I'm going to do 5 minutes on one end. I'm going to finish 5 minutes early because you guys, your brains must be fried because mine certainly is. Here's my final little challenge to you. And look, these aren't slightly random, but this is, if Jesus is raised from the dead, let's be men who have an ambition to serve. Let's be men who fight that obsession with treating women as objects and love them. And let's be men who are generous with our money. I don't think we talk about money very much, particularly with teenagers. I think we tend to think that the adults do that because they've got money. Here's my simple thing, right? If you practice now, you will develop a habit that grows into a lifetime of sacrificial giving. I remember what someone once saying. Okay, imagine you won the... Have you ever imagined winning the lottery? Is anyone? Sure, it's a very sensible thing to have imagined, right? I think we've all sort of imagined winning £10 million, right? Imagine winning £10 million. And I sort of think to myself, I mean, I've never played the lottery, so I don't know how I'd won it, but you sort of think, oh, I imagine somehow I got £10 million. You think, oh, I'd probably give like £9 million of it to church. Because I only need a million. Million is plenty, right? So I could give 9 million of it. That's super generous. I think what church could do with 9 million, and I've got my million, and that's, I'll be alright with that. And this person said, what makes you think that you will be more generous with that much money than you are now? What makes you think that your proportion of generosity would be different just because you've got a lot? You see, if I'm not giving anything now, why on earth do I imagine something when I've got 10 million I'm going to give it? We like to think we would. But the challenge, I think, is, well, start now then. Just start. Start giving money. You may say, well, I haven't got any money. All right, well, give what you haven't got. I think it does make me laugh. It was my birthday on Thursday, and my middle son phoned me on Tuesday and said, Dad, don't look at the Amazon account, because I bought your birthday present, and it's arriving. And it's on your card. I bought myself a birthday present through my generous son. But what you do have, think about how you could use it. Again, I think it's the most exciting thing when perhaps you hear of someone in the church who's struggling for money, or a need comes up. What if you could give some money to help them? And here's the real challenge. If you want it to be like super challenging, then do it without them knowing. Do it so that no one knows you've done it. That's what Jesus says true giving looks like. You see, that's the trouble, right? I give, but then I like people to know that I've given. So I send someone a gift and I make sure I sign the card so they know who it's from. Because then they'll say thank you to me, then I'll feel good. Jesus says, actually, because he's raised from the dead and because God is in heaven, he sees what you do. And the ultimate act of faith when it comes to giving is to give a chunk of money and for no one to know you've done it. And then to say, Father, I did that for you. I did it because I love you. You see, the alternative is that you just store up as much money as you can. You grab money. And Jesus says, well, why don't you use what you've got to serve others rather than to serve yourself? So that's my third little challenge about being kind of growing up as a godly man who takes seriously the fact that Jesus has risen from the dead. I think it really does change how you use your money now. Talk about 2 minutes. How do you find, have you ever given, you know, tell each other how much you give? talk about how you feel about giving. Any questions about it? And then we'll do some couple of questions and then we'll wrap up. Questions on the whole thing of giving money? Everyone happy? Yes?
It's not a question, but just that, what you said about the lottery and doing well with small amounts first. I heard a quote recently that really challenged me and said, God measures our giving by what we keep.
Yeah, that's good, yeah. Yeah. Which is, so Jesus in the temple with the widow, right? Who put in 2 little coins, and we go, 2 coins, that's rubbish, what's the point of that? And she says, yeah, but she put in everything she had to live on. And she gave more than anyone else. It's like so beautiful, yeah.
What if you don't have any?
Great. If you don't have any money, then I want to encourage you that one day you might, to be prepared to put it. It's your birthday soon, yeah. But also, there's lots of other ways we can give. So my wife, I know she's not a boy, but she's still a Christian. She, when she became a Christian, she was about 12 or something, and her parents aren't Christians. And when she became Christian, she went home and she hoovered the whole house without her parents knowing. But she did it because she wanted to do something to show that she loved Jesus and that she wanted to serve Jesus. So there's ways of kind of the way that we live our lives, the way that we treat those around us, that we can cultivate a generous heart to others that looks for opportunities to give. Or even like at the meal table when there's like one roast potato left. You can practice generosity. We've all been there, right? You cut the piece of cake and it's like, who's got the biggest piece? And it's just bigger than mine. And it's like learning a generous heart that says, yeah, I want to give to others. Good, okay, we're going to wrap up and finish. Why don't I pray? Thanks for your patience. I have some thoughts. Father, we want to pray that you'd help us to be men who see that Jesus is so beautiful. Thank you that Jesus has risen from the dead, that he's alive forever and ever. And Lord, this stuff, the stuff that we spend our money on, Lord, the things that we think will satisfy us now, Lord, they're so short compared to the beauty of given us in Jesus. So we pray that we'd be men who are willing to give up everything for Jesus, willing to do things your way, willing helping to love those around us, to serve those around us. Lord, help us, we pray. Thank you for every person in this room. Lord, just to think of the potential in this room, men who will grow up to follow you and to love you.